Hello, I'm Dr. Aley Kalapila from Emory University. In this National HIV Curriculum mini-lecture, I'm going to provide a brief review on the prophylaxis and treatment of Disseminated Mycobacterium Avium Complex infection, which I will refer to as MAC, in people living with HIV. So this is going to be the outline of my talk. I will start with a background, followed by reviewing the prevention of MAC infection. Then we will go over clinical manifestations and how you make a diagnosis of disseminated MAC. I will then discuss treatment options for MAC disease, followed by common side effects associated with the medications, and then finally a summary. Now let's dive right into the background. So MAC is a group of non-tuberculous mycobacteria, and it is an acid-fast bacilli, commonly abbreviated as AFB, that contaminate environmental sources of infection, such as food and water, which means that they are ubiquitous in the environment. So this means that avoiding exposure isn't really feasible, and of course our exposure occurs via the respiratory or the gastrointestinal tracts, so typically that is either inhalation or ingestion. Now, most people with HIV who develop MAC disease have a CD4 count less than 50, and many are either unaware of their HIV diagnosis or they are not on suppressive antiretroviral therapy. Disseminated MAC disease in people with HIV typically presents as a multi-organ infection, although you could occasionally see localized disease. In general, though, with the widespread use of combination antiretroviral therapy to treat HIV, the incidence of disseminated MAC infection in people with HIV has drastically declined. Now let's discuss how one can prevent MAC disease. So in general, as I mentioned earlier, there is no way to prevent environmental exposure to MAC organisms given how widespread they are in our surroundings. Primary prophylaxis against disseminated MAC is not recommended for adults and adolescents with HIV who immediately initiate ART. This recommendation is based on data from several observational cohort studies that found no benefit in starting MAC prophylaxis in persons with a CD4 count less than 50 if they promptly started ART and achieved HIV virologic suppression. People with HIV who are not receiving ART or who are viremic on ART and have no current options for a fully suppressive ART regimen can receive or should receive chemoprophylaxis against disseminated MAC disease if they have a CD4 count less than 50. If you plan to initiate MAC prophylaxis, you should exclude active MAC infection by a clinical evaluation and obtaining a mycobacterial or AFB blood culture. And this is because we typically use one drug for MAC prophylaxis, but 2 to 3 drugs to treat MAC infection. So use of monotherapy for MAC prophylaxis may result in acquired drug resistance in those with active MAC infection or active MAC disease. Now, just a couple of additional points to make here. The first is that the AFB blood cultures are incubated for 6 weeks and MAC can take a long time to grow in culture. So oftentimes you may have already initiated MAC prophylaxis before the AFB culture has been finalized. So it is important for the clinician to follow up on the AFB blood culture results, and if those blood culture results are positive, confirming that the individual has disseminated MAC disease, then the MAC prophylaxis should immediately be discontinued and MAC treatment should be started to avoid drug resistance. Now, in general, with primary MAC prophylaxis, if it has been previously initiated, it can be discontinued if the patient is continued on a fully suppressive ART regimen. Now, this is a table showing the drugs you can use for primary prophylaxis for disseminated MAC. Again, to reiterate, primary prophylaxis is not recommended for patients who are started or receiving an adequate fully suppressive ART regimen. We would only use primary prophylaxis if the individual is not on antiretroviral therapy or they are not virally suppressed on the ART regimen and they have a CD4 count less than 50. The main prophylaxis preferred regimen used is a macrolide antibiotic, so either azithromycin or clarithromycin. In general, I personally prefer to use the azithromycin once weekly dosing due to less frequent dosing and because the azithromycin is actually associated with fewer GI side effects compared to clarithromycin. The alternative regimen to use for primary prophylaxis is rifabutin. And remember that rifabutin is a rifamycin drug, and rifamycins are the mainstay for tuberculosis treatment, so it is important to rule out active TB prior to initiating rifabutin. Now let's get into some more details on the clinical manifestations and diagnosis of disseminated MAC disease. For people living with HIV with a low CD4 count, less than 50, who are not on ART, MAC disease presents as a disseminated multi-organ infection. Symptoms may include fever, night sweats, weight loss, fatigue, diarrhea, and abdominal pain. Physical exam findings include hepatomegaly, splenomegaly, or lymphadenopathy. Lab derangements include cytopenias, especially anemia, and sometimes even pancytopenia because MAC can invade the bone marrow. You may also see an elevated lactate dehydrogenase or LDH and/or elevated alkaline phosphatase levels as well. Now, the diagnosis of disseminated MAC is usually made by the isolation of MAC from cultures of the blood, lymph node, bone marrow, or other normally sterile tissue or body fluids. Use of mycobacterial blood cultures to isolate MAC has become the preferred method of diagnosis. Among persons with untreated disseminated MAC, obtaining two sets of blood cultures has a sensitivity of greater than 90%. Remember that MAC blood cultures are incubated for 6 weeks, but usually the lab may detect mycobacterial growth by day 14. Once there is growth, the mycobacterium species can be identified using DNA probes. Okay. Now let's move on to treatment of disseminated MAC infection. The opportunistic infection guidelines recommend that initial treatment for disseminated MAC consists of at least two active drugs, typically a macrolide plus ethambutol. So the options would be azithromycin and ethambutol or clarithromycin and ethambutol. Most clinicians prefer azithromycin, as I mentioned before, because of better tolerance and fewer problematic drug interactions. And the macrolide drug susceptibility testing is recommended for all people with HIV. Now, some experts would recommend the addition of a third or fourth drug in settings in which the risk of mortality is increased and the emergence of drug resistance is very likely. And this can happen when there's advanced immunosuppression or high mycobacterial loads or the absence of effective antiretroviral therapy. The third drug added on that is usually preferred by clinicians is either rifabutin, and the fourth drug can include either a fluoroquinolone such as levofloxacin or amoxifloxacin, which have in vitro and animal model activity against MAC, or an injectable agent such as amikacin or streptomycin. Now, with regard to the initiation of antiretroviral therapy, this should be started as soon as possible and without delay. It is important to ensure that the ART drugs used do not interact with the medications used to treat the disseminated MAC infection. Treatment response is monitored by looking at clinical improvement. If patients fail to respond within 4 to 8 weeks after initiating antimycobacterial therapy, then repeat AFB blood cultures for MAC should be obtained. Immune reconstitution inflammatory syndrome, or IRIS, is a systemic inflammatory syndrome with signs and symptoms that are clinically indistinguishable from active MAC infection. Now, MAC-associated IRIS can occur as an unmasking IRIS. So these are the patients who you see in your clinic who may have very subtle or no symptoms of MAC infection. You start them on antiretroviral therapy and they start to feel better. They have an initial improvement in their symptoms based on viral suppression and immune reconstitution that they've gotten with the ART. But then the MAC infection is unmasked and patients start to experience more moderate to severe symptoms of disseminated MAC disease. Now, people with HIV on ART who develop symptoms associated with MAC IRIS can receive initial treatment with non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs or NSAIDs, but if the symptoms don't improve or they have far more severe symptoms, then a prolonged corticosteroid taper might be needed in order to manage their MAC IRIS. Regardless, ART should be continued throughout the treatment of MAC iris and should not be stopped because the morbidity and mortality associated with MAC iris is low and the long-term prognosis is good. Now, MAC treatment can be discontinued once the patient has successfully completed 12 months or more of MAC therapy and they have no signs or symptoms of MAC disease and they have a sustained increase in CD4 count to greater than 100 for greater than or equal to 6 months in response to antiretroviral therapy. Disseminated MAC therapy should be restarted if it has been discontinued before, if the patient's CD4 count decreases to less than 100, and fully suppressive antiretroviral therapy isn't feasible for the patient. Now let's talk about some medication side effects. With the macrolides, so specifically azithromycin and clarithromycin, the most common potential side effects that can be seen are gastrointestinal disturbance, with clarithromycin causing worse GI side effects compared to azithromycin. Both can also cause a prolonged QTC. Ethambutol can cause an optic neuritis, which is dose and duration dependent for the drug. So these individuals who are on ethambutol should have a regular ophthalmologic evaluation. Rifabutin turns body secretions orange. It can cause hepatotoxicity, and it is notorious for drug-drug interactions since it is a CYP450 inducer. Fluoroquinolones can cause diarrhea. They can cause prolonged QTC as well as tendinopathies. Aminoglycosides, which are used for disseminated MAC treatment, are associated with renal toxicity, neurotoxicity, and ototoxicity. So finally, in summary, MAC is a non-tuberculous mycobacteria that can cause disseminated multi-organ infection in people with HIV with a CD4 count less than 50. Primary prophylaxis is not routinely indicated if a fully suppressive ART regimen has been initiated. The diagnosis of MAC infection can be made if individuals present with clinical symptoms suggestive of disseminated MAC disease and the organism is isolated from a sterile site, usually blood. Preferred treatment of disseminated MAC consists of azithromycin or clarithromycin plus ethambutol. Treatment is for 12 months or longer and until the individual has a CD4 count greater than 100 and also is on a fully suppressive ART regimen. But regardless of the MAC diagnosis, ART should be initiated as soon as possible.
The production of this national HIV curriculum mini lecture was supported by grant U10HA32104 from the Health Resources and Services Administration of the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. Its contents are solely the responsibility of the University of Washington IDEA program and do not necessarily represent the official views of HRSA or HHS.